In this video, we're going to talk about redox reactions and start looking into the specifics of the light reactions of photosynthesis. What we are going to see is that as a metabolic pathway, both photosynthesis and cellular respiration involve many redox reactions. Chemical reactions which transfer electrons from one substance to another are called oxidation reduction reactions, or redox reactions for short. During these chemical reactions, some atoms give away electrons or lose electrons, whereas other atoms gain or receive electrons. We call the loss of electrons during a redox reaction oxidation. Whereas the acceptance of electrons during a redox reaction is called reduction. So oxidation is loss of electrons, reduction is gain of electrons. This is a bit counterintuitive, because why would gaining electrons be called reduction? Well, it goes back to our understanding that electrons have negative electrical charges. So if a molecule is gaining electrons, its overall electrical charge is being reduced or made more negative. Now, one way to possibly remember the names of these two steps in a redox reaction is through the acronym oil rig. So for oil rig, oxidation is loss of electrons, whereas reduction is gain of electrons. So oil, oxidation is loss, rig, reduction is gain. And remember that we're talking about the loss or gain of electrons. Hopefully, this memory aid will help you remember the difference between the oxidation and reduction steps of a redox reaction. So let's see how these redox reactions are used during the light reactions of photosynthesis. You may wonder, why is transferring electrons important or significant for photosynthesis? Well, we discussed that potential energy can be stored in an object based on its position or location. The same is true for electrons. They can store more or less potential energy based on their position. If an electron is at a high energy state, we call that an excited state. And that means that it has more stored energy. Now, the electron, it still has its negative charge, it's still made out of the same materials. It's just in a position in which it has higher energy. Electrons are less stable when they store this extra energy, so they will try to release that energy soon after they have absorbed it. Often this comes in the form of fluorescence, which is a release of light and heat. In photosynthesis, the pigment chlorophyll absorbs energy from light. That energy is transferred to the electrons, taking it to that excited state. Now, if nothing were to be done with that electron, it would simply release that energy and return back to its ground state. But what happens in photosynthesis is that when that electron becomes energized, before it has a chance to release that energy, it is then taken away from the pigment, transferred through a series of proteins in an electron transport chain. This electron transfer is a series of redox reactions. Light is absorbed by the pigment chlorophyll. The energy of that absorbed light is then transferred to the electrons of that chlorophyll. That high energy electron is then taken away from chlorophyll. Now what we'll see is that there are actually two photosystems that operate during the light reactions. One photosystem splits water into oxygen atoms, hydrogen protons, and electrons, and then it steals those electrons from water. We'll see why that is in just a moment. The other photosystem receives electrons from the first and uses them to reduce molecules of NADP+, and these are the empty shuttle buses, into NADPH, or a filled shuttle bus. Light is used in both of these photosystems to energize the electrons. So we have our two photosystems. The water-splitting photosystem, also known as photosystem 2, and the NADPH-producing photosystem, or photosystem 1. Now you may be wondering why photosystem 2 seems to be acting before photosystem 1. And it is true, the activity of photosystem 2 does happen first. Unfortunately, these photosystems were named based on the order in which they were discovered. And so the NADPH-producing photosystem was the first discovered. It wasn't until later that we discovered the water-splitting photosystem. So I apologize on behalf of science for the poor naming of these photosystems. This is one of the reasons why I prefer the more descriptive names of water-splitting photosystem and NADPH-producing photosystem. But let's look at what's happening in each of these photosystems. So, with the water-splitting photosystem, light is absorbed, electrons are energized, those electrons are then taken away from that chlorophyll, passing down a series of electron transport chains, all the while releasing energy. The energy that's released by those electrons ultimately is used to make ATP, and we'll talk a bit more about that in just a moment. But we've left photosystem 2 with a problem. It had electrons, those electrons were energized, and now those electrons were taken away. It needs to replace those electrons, and the easiest way for it to do that is to split water molecules into hydrogen protons, oxygen atoms, and electrons. It then takes those electrons away from the water. The hydrogen protons dissociate into the solution, and it's the oxygen atoms that end up combining together to form oxygen gas. So, what happened to the electrons that were taken away from photosystem 2? Well, they traveled down an electron transport chain, releasing their energy that will ultimately be used to make ATP. When those electrons arrive at the NADPH-producing photosystem, they're back to being low-energy electrons, so more light is absorbed at photosystem 1. Those electrons become energized, and again, those energized electrons are taken away from photosystem 1. In this case, those high-energy electrons are now loaded onto the shuttle bus molecules, reducing NADP+ into NADPH. And so actually, molecules of ATP and molecules of NADPH, these are the two forms of chemical energy made during the light reactions. So, there are two types of chemical energy produced during the light reactions. These are energized molecules of ATP and NADPH. These chemical energy products will be used during the Calvin cycle to form sugar. So let's look at the activity of these two photosystems. The water-splitting photosystem, or photosystem 2, it splits water molecules into electrons, oxygen gas, and hydrogen protons. It then energizes the electrons, which end up entering the electron transport chain. Energy from electron transport is used to pump hydrogen protons across that thylakoid membrane. So those protons are being pumped from the stroma into the thylakoid membrane. This generates a proton gradient. So electrons are energized by absorbing light, are sent down the electron transport chain through a series of redox reactions, and more electrons have to replace the ones that are lost by the splitting of water molecules. Once those electrons arrive at photosystem 1, those electrons are energized again. Once these electrons are energized a second time, they are then loaded onto the empty shuttle buses. NADPH is produced from NADP plus in the stroma electrons. From photosystem 1 and hydrogen ions, also from the stroma. This is how we get our energized molecules of NADPH. Through the actions of these two photosystems, there are now a bunch of hydrogen protons in the thylakoid space and very few hydrogen protons in the stroma. This is a concentration gradient, and that proton gradient represents stored energy. Diffusion is going to want to equalize that proton concentration on both sides of the membrane. But ions cannot diffuse through a membrane on their own. They need to have a channel protein. And in this case, there's a very specific channel protein known as ATP synthase. ATP synthase is a channel for protons or hydrogen ions to pass from one side of the membrane to the other. But as those protons move through ATP synthase, it is able to use the energy of movement to charge molecules of ATP. So proton movement through ATP synthase drives phosphorylation, or the addition of a phosphate, in essence recharging those molecules of ADP into ATP. And so this is how we get our second type of chemical energy, ATP. So both NADPH and ATP, these are the two forms of chemical energy made during the light reactions. To summarize the two steps of these photosystems, photosystem 2, or the water splitting photosystem, energizes electrons by absorbing light. Those electrons are taken away, passed to photosystem 1, and in doing so, that energy ultimately results in the production of ATP. In photosystem 1, another photon of light is absorbed. The electrons are energized, and those electrons are then loaded onto the electron shuttle buses, or NADPH. These two forms of chemical energy will then be used during the Calvin cycle. This concludes our discussion of the light reaction. I know this was a lot of information, and so there will be an overview video of the light reactions next. After that, we'll discuss the Calvin cycle, and we can see how the Calvin cycle is going to use the chemical energy made by the light reactions and convert it into glucose. Thanks for your attention, and I'll see you in the next video.